The title of this talk is The Spread of the Neolithic in Europe, Simulations versus Archaeological and Genetic Data. And it's dedicated to the memory of Luca Cavalli Sforza. As you know, there are several models of Neolithic transitions. The demic diffusion model shows that it was a spread of farming duration. So the driving mechanisms in this model behind the spread of the Neolithic are the dispersal of farmers and their reproduction. In contrast, the cultural diffusion model assumes that the Neolithic was a spread of ideas, so that there were no substantial movements of farming populations. But the mechanism behind the spread here in this model is the transmission of plants, animals, and knowledge from farmers to hunter-gatherers. And there are also the demic-cultural models, which are more general. So these two models are a special case of this one. So we shall discuss a little bit these kind of models. In order to do so, first we have to estimate the spread rate of the Neolithic. As it is well known, Ammerman and Cavalli Sforza many years ago found that the Neolithic spread in Europe at a rate of about 1 kilometer per year. This is a more recent analysis with many more sites, and it gives essentially the same result, about 1 kilometer per year, or more precisely between 0.9 and 1.3 kilometers per year. This range is important in this talk, and we will use it in the next slide. So the spread of the Neolithic, according to the regression of dates and distances, was between 0.9 and 1.3 kilometers per year. We show this range as the blue rectangle in this slide. So here we have between 0.9 and 1.3 kilometers per year. The vertical axis is the speed of the Neolithic farming. And we show two lines which give the spread rate of the Neolithic wave of advance as a function of the cultural transmission intensity. This parameter C has a very simple interpretation. It's the number of hunter-gatherers that converted into farmers for each pioneering farmer and generation. So for example, if C is 10, it means that 10 hunter-gatherers were converted into farmers, either via interbreeding or via acculturation, for each pioneering farmer and generation. So we see that the speed increases with increasing values of C, which is what we should be what we should expect, because if C is larger, then more hunter-gatherers are converted into farmers, so there are more farmers, so the spread should be faster. And these two curves correspond to the maximum and the minimum reproduction values from ethnographic data, but I have no time to discuss the parameter values and the details of the model. Also, later I will present some of the model equations so it can be understood. If you're interested, also intuitively it's very easy to understand, and the same that can be obtained from equations can be done via numerical simulations on a grid of points. So the equations are not really important. And this slide comes directly from the previous one. It's just the cultural effect defined as the speed minus the demic speed, which is the speed for C equals zero. This is the demic speed, because if C is zero, then zero hunter-gatherers are converted into farmers, so there is no cultural transmission. So the model is purely demic. So the speed minus the demic speed is the cultural effect relative to the total speed in percentage. And from the previous slide, we can plot these curves, and we see that since in this slide, we see that the observed range, which is between 0.9 and 0.3 kilometers per year, is this one. These spread rates are too fast, so this region, this red region, is inconsistent with archaeology because the model is too fast to agree with the data. So C is less than 3, so less than 300 riders were converted per farmer by generation. So here we have to disregard this region. We can only consider the region where C is less than 3, and for this region the cultural effect is less than 48%, which is less than 50%. So the importance of cultural transmission or cultural diffusion was surely smaller than the importance of demic diffusion. So archaeology implies that the Neolithic spread in Europe was mainly demic, according to this model. Later we will see what genetics implied, and we will see that it adds a lot of information to this very same project. But before doing so, we can, since in this session, a topic that is considered is the spread and the pace of the Neolithic civilization, we can consider this interpolation map of the dates of many sites. We see that, as it is well known, that Neolithic came from the southeast. It's around the Alps, later it climbed the mountains and went to the north, more slowly because here the isochrones are closer together. And as well, it's in the Alps that you need the other regions. In the Mediterranean, it was much faster. Here we can estimate the spread rate in different regions, and as expected, we see that in the Alps and Northern Europe, it was slower than 0.7 kilometers per year. And in the other regions, it was faster. For example, in the West Mediterranean, here we show as diamonds the earliest sites in each region. If the diamond is white, it means that the front arrives in time. If it's black, it means that the front arrives too early. For inland travel, without sea travel, it's too early. So the model does not agree with the data. The model that agrees with the data requires that the jumps per generation along the coast are at least of 350 kilometers. So in this case, the spread was much faster and about 8.7 kilometers per year, very much faster than the average of 1 kilometer per year. And it's due to, we think, to these long jumps. Then finally, we turn to ancient genetics. We have gathered a database of Neolithic individuals, a total of 513, whose mitochondrial DNA has been determined. We analyze haplogroup K because its frequency, which is shown here in red, decreases westwards and northwards in farmers, and it is absent in hunter-gatherers. This is what we should expect if there is demic diffusion and some degree of cultural diffusion. Why? Because for some time, for any given time, the places located farther away from the origin of the expansion still have more hunter-gatherers, so the cultural transmission is stronger and the Neolithic marker will decrease faster. This is what is called the genetic line. This is the same as the previous slide, but here we present it in another way. This is the percentage of the Neolithic marker of haplogroup K. So, for example, in Syria, 40% of early Neolithic farmers have the Neolithic genetic marker, have haplogroup K. It decreases to the west and to the north, to Anatolia, Hungary, Croatia, Germany, northeastern Spain, Sweden, Navarre, and Portugal. These squares are the earliest, the oldest Neolithic data. And this line is a regression, which is nothing but a genetic line. Okay. So the frequency of the Neolithic marker decreases as the Neolithic wave expands. We also see that for the triangles, which are more recent genetic data, the values are generally slower, so the frequency decreases in time. This is also what we should expect intuitively, because in this model we are only assuming that farmers can interbreed with or can incorporate hunter-gatherers in their communities. So, since hunter-gatherers do not have a Neolithic marker, because no hunter-gatherer has been found in Europe with haplogroup K, then as hunter-gatherers are incorporated, the frequency of the Neolithic marker of haplogroup K should decrease. And this is what we see. So we perform some simulations in order to try to explain this quantitatively. Simulations begin with some farmers only at this site, Rasanga, which is the oldest PPND site in Syria, in this database, at the date reported there. We set the initial percentage of haplogroup K at the cell in the grid, in the simulation grid, which is a rectangular grid of square cells. At the cell containing this site, this initial site, the origin of the expansion, by trial and error, so that the simulation gives the observed percentage at the average location and date of the early farmers in Syria whose mitochondrial DNA is known. So these are the initial conditions, the right place and the right initial percentage of the genetic Neolithic marker. All other grid cells, of course, are initially empty of farmers and with hunter-gatherers at the saturation density. Then each node of the grid is classified as inland, coast, mountain, and ocean. At each node or cell in the grid, at a time step of one generation, we compute three processes. First, inland dispersal of farmers between both cells with sites 50 kilometers and probability 62%, both values being obtained from ethnographic data. And also sea travel of farmers up to 100 kilometers, so that the arrival times agree with the archaeological data on average for the East and West Mediterranean. A more elaborate model could consider, for example, longer distances in the west of 350 kilometers, as we have seen before. But this study was done simultaneously to the previous one, and I don't think it would change the results. It surely the conclusion would be the same. Then the other two steps, each generation for all nodes or cells in the grid, are cultural transmission and reproduction of the population. Cultural transmission is done as follows. Since we have to compute the percentage of the Neolithic marker of the haplogroup K, which, because we want to compare it to the data, we have to distinguish the farmers who have haplogroup K, PN, and the farmers who do not have haplogroup K, PX. Because the percentage of farmers who have haplogroup K is the number that have it divided by the total number of farmers, those who have it plus those who do not have it. And we also compute the number of hunter-gatherers, and we stress once again that no hunter-gatherer has haplogroup K, because no many hunter-gatherers have been analyzed, and in Europe there has never been found any hunter-gatherer who has haplogroup K. This is why we are analyzing this marker. If we analyze another marker, we would have to know how many hunter-gatherers have it, and there is not enough data so far. So we apply cultural transmission theory to compute the couples, the mixed couples between hunters, eggs, and farmers, either with haplogroup K, with an Neolithic marker, N, or without it, X. This is given by this equation. C is the cultural diffusion intensity. It's the same parameter as we have used previously in the archaeological analysis. The cultural transmission intensity, the number of hunters that become farmers per pioneering farmer generation. And we also compute the random the couples of farmers. Here, cultural transmission does not play any role, so C does not appear, because cultural transmission takes place between hunters and farmers. So between hunters and farmers and olives. But not between farmers and farmers if they are all farmers, so here there is not any bias in the choice of mates. This should be equal. And finally, reproduction. We apply a reproduction is couple of farmers has to R0 children, where R0 is the net reproduction rate per farmer. And for 50% of mixed matings between hunter and farmer, children are X, which means that in 50% of mixed matings, the mother is a hunter-gatherer, because the mitochondrial DNA is transmitted from mother to children. And this is the simplest model. In another more elaborated model, we assume that all mothers are hunter-gatherers, which is more in agreement with ethnographic data, but the results were almost the same. So here we have the results. These are the same error bars from the data as before, and the lines have been obtained from the simulations. If C is equal to zero, there is no cultural transmission. There is not any hunter-gatherer who becomes a farmer. So the haplogroup K, the Neolithic marker, cannot change. So it's a constant. The stronger the cultural transmission, the higher the value of C, then the more important the decrease due to the incorporation of Neolithic people of the Neolithic marker in the population. And we see that C is very small. From the archaeological data, we have seen before that C must be less than 3. But here we find that it is about 0.02 and not very different from this. So genetics should be combined with archaeology if possible, because you can get more out of additional information. And well, here there is a minimum, here there is a maximum. I don't have time to explain it, but it's due to the two routes, the England route and the Mediterranean group, and the yellow regions are those in the previous slide, so here are the minimum of it. And it's easy to understand why one route has the inland route has a steeper flow, and this yields the minimum. It's simply because the distance between jumps is longer for the seaboard. Okay, I don't have time to explain this in detail, but the important point is that if we go back to the results from archaeology, we had that this region is inconsistent with archaeology, C must be less than 3, but genetics pinpoints a much narrower region. See about 0.02, so only 2% of farmers were involved in cultural diffusion, so 98% of farmers did not play any role either on vertical or horizontal cultural diffusion, which is this conclusion had not been obtained before, but it's in agreement with genome-wide data that show that the spread was overwhelmingly demic. But genome-wide data cannot be used to estimate the number of farmers. For reasons that I cannot explain because I don't have time. So, and the cultural effect was only about 2%. So, this completes my talk. Thank you for your attention.